Hey guys, Darren here.
Ben here.
And we have heard that a lot of questions around home hubs coming from you all, and we got together because we have some too to ask each other and hopefully answer for one another.
For the next 2 minutes to help you to understand all the answers to those questions and then some. Yeah. So take a look. Here you go.
So what is a home hub?
I'm glad you asked, Darren. A home hub is this place of intimate relationship and community. One that refines each other in the desert and in the plentiful lands of the promised land. A place in which we just get to gather together on a weekly basis and be able to be sanctified in the Holy Spirit in ways in which we've never experienced.
Ben, I think you've been a pastor for way too long. It sounds like you're talking about small groups.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly what thank you. It's a small group. It's a small group that meets in somebody's home on a weekly basis. Darren, so when do these things start? When does a home hub start?
Good question, Ben, and I'm glad you asked. They actually started about a week ago. The first few home hubs have launched, and we're still launching more, just waiting for more people to sign up.
That's right. So who's to be part of a home hub?
Everyone.
Everyone.
Yeah.
Everyone. I mean, if you're breathing, we'll take you, right? Like,
yeah. Right. We have home hubs currently all over Clark County. We have some in Vancouver, Ridgefield, and Battleground, and that is expanding based on you all, because we actually want home hubs everywhere that you call home.
How do you get involved, Darren?
It's actually really easy. If you can see this video, then there should be a place right down here. Just scroll down your screen
right there.
And comment.
Or maybe right there. I don't know.
Or if you need to, 360-771-1855. Just call me right now.
Right now.
Right now. Call me.
Right now.
Oh.
Oh, that was cool. That was
yeah,
quick.
Yeah, yeah. Hello?
It's fine.
So why are we even doing these home hubs?
Glad you asked. Because we miss you. During this COVID time, we've only seen you through a screen, and this gives us an opportunity to meet in homes and actually be able to see one another face to face. It's part of who we are. We love being around one another. SGC is all about our community, and this is an opportunity for us to do that. But there's a resilience that we need to have for the future. I don't know. I'm thinking that this may not be the only pandemic.
It's the zombie apocalypse, for sure. It's on the radar.
Oh, I think so. I think it's about time the Living Dead is going to be here.
Yeah, so I don't know about you, Ben, but if that's the case, I don't think I'm going to run to the church to find my inner community.
Suddenly, coffee doesn't really matter a whole lot, does it? And certainly not my preaching. But you know what would matter is a group of people that I know that will support me even when my brains are trying to get eaten by the zombies. Okay. So we hope that you would get involved in a home hub. It's something that is worthwhile to consider because this is where life begins. So, consider it. Make sure you contact this guy. Give him a call. Comment below. We'll get you involved. Talk to you guys later. Morning, church. Pastor Ben here. This is your family update. We want to let you know that next Sunday we'll be doing a live stream service in the sanctuary. We're really excited about this, to be able to have something that's back to a little bit normal church service, and we're going to have some people come and join us for some time in the sanctuary as well. We'll start with a couple of home hubs and a group of you who may not be in a home hub, or if your home hub is not invited that Sunday, we will invite you through a sign-up genius list that will allow us to stay within our allowed capacity. We'll make sure that we make every opportunity that we can to make sure that those who can come to a physical worship service has room to do that. We'll even have a little bit of room for guests, people who may come from our community that want to just come. But we want you to just be aware of those things. So look forward to those people to be coming. The George Home Hub and the Van Hoy's Home Hub will be the first two to come join us. And we want you to be part of that service in scripture reading and testimonies as well. For those of you who are signing up on the Sign Up Genius, you'll get that link on our Facebook page and on the email this week. And we'll ask that you can sign up to make sure that we stay within the capacity of the service. But please, we want to make sure that we're doing the best we can to keep one another safe, to be able to also make sure that we are people who allow anybody who wants to come to church can come. And so we're working hard to do that. And if we start filling up in capacity, what we will do is look into the things of what it looks like to have two services going. But until then, we're going to take one step at a time, one step closer to the things of what we're doing. But certainly we want to encourage you to take advantage of the home hubs, have times of small group fellowship together, and certainly let us know if you're interested in being part of one of those. But we're excited about a good service today. We are excited about what God's going to be doing. We're in our week 3 of our Pursuit series, and today we're going to talk about what it means to have a tone, a task, and a technique to the ways in which we pursue and the ways in which God pursues us. So let us get started. We are glad that you're here. Happy Sunday.
Well, good morning, Starting Grounds Church. It is wonderful to be with you this morning. As we enter into a time of worship through music and song, we encourage you to sing along at home and to find a posture of worship that allows you to engage fully this morning. Lord, we come before your throne, knowing that you hold our lives in your hands. We ask for that to be made fresh and made new to us this morning, God. And so we lift our voices to you.
We lift our voices.
hunger and thirst for you, God, to know you more and to be known by you. Let us continue singing together. And all who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to grateful for your presence, Lord, that you would come to us, that you would speak into our lives. We look to you, God, as we figure out how to lift one another up, as we look to reach out to those who don't know you. May we be malleable, may we be responsive to your spirit, God, that we see all as your children, just waiting to hear the good word, to know that they are loved. We lift this to you, God. As we sing All the Poor and Powerless. All the poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, all the thieves will come confess and know that you are holy, and know that you sing out of your name, Lord. You are holy. we sing to you, God.
Family, and happy Sunday. It's a blessing to be with you again this week. This week we are going to be wrapping up our series entitled Outrageous. I hope you have been blessed and that you have learned some things in these past few weeks about how God uses ordinary people like you and me to do really outrageous things. So this week our story finds us with King David. Now, this is the same King David from one of our favorite stories of David and Goliath. Now David is an adult. He is the king of Israel. God has blessed his life, and he is the ruler of Israel, and he is a father. He has several kids, and one of them is named Absalom. Now, Absalom was very good looking. He was tall and strong, and he had long flowing hair that he was very proud of. Well, Absalom worked really hard for a lot of his life to get everyone in Israel to really like him, and it worked. After a while, everyone was just so crazy about him. They thought that he was the coolest. And he had some wicked in his heart. Even though he may have been very handsome on the outside, his insides were pretty ugly. And he convinced all of the people to turn against King David and to fight him in a war. Absalom had so much evil in his heart toward his dad that he wanted to fight him and try to kill him. So they have this big fight, and the battle gets super intense, and it ends up that Absalom's hair gets stuck in a tree, making it unable for him to get away, and he gets captured by David's army, and sadly, he's killed. But the real lesson of the story here is that King David, when he heard that Absalom had been killed in the war, his heart was so broken. He was so, so sad. And he just cried out before the Lord. He didn't want that to happen. That wasn't his goal. That wasn't what his heart had wanted. But isn't that how God is to us? That's the same way that God's love is toward us. He loves us even when we're making bad choices, even when we're in the middle of doing things that go against him. He loves us anyway. Now, that doesn't give us permission to go and be naughty or to do things we know that God wouldn't have us to do. But it gives us the comfort of knowing that when we mess up or when we get too full of ourselves, like Absalom was, God is still there. His love is still there. And we need to make it right, and we need to keep trying and doing our best. But God loves us even when we are not doing our best, even while we are still sinners. That's what our memory verse says this week. So if you've got your Bible, open up with me to the New Testament, the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 8. And it says, but God demonstrates his love for us. So demonstrates means to show. Even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So that doesn't say that God only chose to die for us only when we were doing what was right. Only when we were just being our best and doing all the right things and nailing it. No, God knew that we were not going to be perfect. He knew that we needed a Savior, and he knew that we were going to still fall short and mess up. So even on our darkest days of just having a terrible, no good, very bad day, God still loves us, even in the middle of all of the sin. I pray that that encourages your heart this week, and I pray that you will look for ways that you can show the love of God to others. If someone does something toward you and you just are so frustrated by it and you know that it was wrong of them, I pray that you will choose to love them like Jesus and pray for them and extend grace and mercy to them this week. I love you, friends, and I cannot wait to see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Of our pursuit series, and today we're going to really dive into what it looks like for us to really pursue somebody or to pursue people, and how Jesus did it in such a special way. Last week we talked a little bit about what it meant for us to, for Jesus to call us not to just reformation, but to transformation. And a lot of that has to do with us recognizing our brokenness and seeing that we work on the same plane as anybody else. That when we're called to work with the poor, it's not out of pity or charity. It is to literally identify ourselves with them to see that we are all broken and we have that kind of need for a savior. And when we're able to do that, we are able to see one another just as Jesus does. And so when we become bearers of grace, we also can be givers of grace as well. And we see that we are nothing more special than anybody else. And that is an important role for us to understand. When God pursues us, it's because we are in need of reconciliation, restoration, that God is calling us to do the same to the world and to the people around us. Today, we're going to talk a little bit more mechanically of how God does this. But we're going to continue in the story which Jesus has, which is very cool, about this banquet and what it looks like for Jesus to kind of call people to the table. We're going to take a little bit of time to look at this guy named Zacchaeus as well. And then, of course, the call, the commission that we have in Matthew 24 and also in Acts 1, verse 8. We have this cool little thing that happens where God just kind of says that you are to go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and into the ends of the world. And that there's a pattern, a call for us to kind of go through those things. And so we kind of see that happening naturally in the book of Acts, where the disciples begin to start in Jerusalem, and then it spreads out with Apostle Paul, even into Rome and to other parts of the world. So what we want to do is kind of identify how we do the same when we pursue people. But today, would we begin to open up our eyes? May we see how we might be struggling to get out of our comfort zone, what it would look like for us to do something different, to reach to the people that we may have overlooked or have been too scared to reach. And what does it look like for us to do that? I don't know about you, but I tend to be kind of that crazy white guy that kind of walks around smiling and saying hi to people. In fact, Alicia a lot of times says, Good morning, church. Today we have our week 3 of our pursuit series, and we're going to talk about tone, task, and technique of what it looks like for God to pursue us and how we're to pursue one another. This is going to be the more mechanical, maybe a little bit more practical, but last week we identified what it means for us to be transformed by God rather than reformed by God. In other words, it's not necessarily about us just being morally good beings. It is for God to do a new work with us, to let the old self die so that the new self can live. And when we begin to do that, we are also able to see that we are just as broken, that God found us, yet while we were still sinners, God came. Not just for those people, but for us people, for we. And so today we are going to identify still with that brokenness, that when I begin to bear the grace of God, that it allows me to give to somebody else. And that when I reach out to the person who may be hurting or struggling, I can identify with that. I can have empathy. I can be a person who says, you are us, and we can be brothers and sisters no matter what background we have or what struggles we have had. That the gospel clears that out, that there could be a new person that happens when Christ pursues us. And so when we work within a world that says that we are to be like-minded and we are supposed to look the same and act the same, that the body of Christ is a little different, that when we pursue one another, we pursue people of all different types. And this can be a very inclusive thing, a thing that says, I'm no better than you. In fact, I'm just as broken. And the only thing that may separate us is that I have experienced the grace of God, and I want to offer that to you as well. But today we're going to get into a little bit more practical things of what does it look like? How does Jesus pursue people, and how does he give an example of that? There's a story of Zacchaeus we're going to get into, and even the call of the Great Commission for us to go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria and to the ends of the earth, and how it's an example in books of Acts where we see the disciples start in Jerusalem and they kind of branch out all the way to Paul, who goes to Rome and a number of other places to the ends of the world. And so we want to be able to say, what is that process? What does that process look like? What does it sound like, look like for us to pursue somebody? And how did God do that for us? So when we get into this, would you begin to ask yourself the questions? What does it mean for me to pursue somebody this week? Is there somebody that God has put in my life? What would it look like if we all decided that we were just going to pursue somebody? How much more would our world be changed? How much more enriched would our community and our church be changed? And so when we get into this word, would you open your eyes and your ears to what God has? Would you be a person who begins to say, God, would you do a new work within me? Would you call me outside of my comfort zone? Because that is where God is going to do the best work, when we surrender those areas of our lives that we have held so tightly to. And so let us get started. We're going to start in Luke, and we're going to read a portion of a parable in which Jesus speaks with the Pharisees. It comes from Luke 14, starting in verse 12, and we're going to end at verse 24. Listen to the word of God. Let it be live and active within you and in the groups in which you are meeting with today. This is the word of the Lord. Luke 14, 12 through 24. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back so that you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, blessed is the one who will eat at the feast of the kingdom of God. Jesus replied, a certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me. Another one said, I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me. Still another said, I just got married, so I can't come. The servant came back and reported to his master, and then the owner of the house became angry and ordered this servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of this town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Sir, the servant said, what you have ordered has been done, but there is still room. Then the master told his servant, go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. The word of God. When I became a Christian, I didn't know how to interact or how to pursue people. In fact, I was so closed up. I was so scared of what it would be like if I looked and made eye contact with people. And I knew I wouldn't be happy. And it was that point in which I realized that I had to at least make eye contact with people and smile. So I said, all right, God, I'm gonna make eye contact and smile. Sooner or later, I got comfortable with that. And then I began to say, okay, I'm gonna say hi. Now I'm that guy that walks around and smiles and waves and says hi to anybody that is willing to acknowledge me. In fact, Alicia a lot of times says, do you know them? I said, no, why? She's like, oh, you said hi. I'm like, well, that's just what I do. But either way, it becomes this habit of mine. In fact, Alicia and I have moved many times, and we generally move into areas that we don't know anybody. And I'm always praying and excited to meet new neighbors. Sometimes I'm just that weird dude that just smiles and waves. When we had a house in Arizona, we had a neighbor across the street that refused to acknowledge me. I mean, like, I would wave, I would say hi, I would try to find ways to make interactions with him. And of course, a lot of times I would wave and he'd see me. I knew he saw me, I knew he heard me, but he'd turn around and just not even acknowledge. It took about 2 years. It was 2 years where one day I see him outside and I smile, I wave, I say, good morning. And he lifted up his hand and he waved and he walked back in his house. I was so excited. I mean, I went in and said, Alicia, he waved. I thought this was a huge breakthrough. It just so happened that the next day the police came and handcuffed him and took him away. Never saw him again. So I'm also a person who likes to use people's names, right? Like that person who pursues people, in which we'll see something that Jesus does specific with Zacchaeus here. But either way, pursuit is this thing that requires us to initiate it. And it's not necessarily with social awkwardness, even though that's just how I carry myself. But it does require us to have a bit of a tone and a task to, and a technique to the ways in which we do it. And it's different for each of us. We find our own voice in our own things, but it's got a particular tone and task involved that requires us to initiate and break the barrier of our comfort zone. In the story today, we have this thing that happens here, that Jesus is meeting with the Pharisees and trying to talk to them about reaching out, what it means for the kingdom of God to be about more than just the righteous, more than just about the chosen people. And he kind of says, when you invite somebody, don't invite the people that you're going to get along with. Don't get the people that are going to repay you. Invite the people who are poor, the lame, the crippled. In other words, pick the people who are least like you, which kind of goes back into our story of last week, that it requires us to recognize our brokenness, that we are not better. We might be further down the road. We might be able to lead people. We may be able to show what God can do in one of our lives. But down in the depths of who we are, I'm still that young man who couldn't make eye contact with people unless it was with an angry face. And so God changes us. He transforms us so that we can initiate and pursue others. Not just the people that we naturally get along with, but the people who are different from us, the people who can learn from us, the people who can gain blessing from us. And that the blessing comes not just from the repayment, not what we get out of the interaction, but what God will do for us. And so pursuit requires this tone, task, and technique. So as Jesus is talking to the disciples and the Pharisees, this man at the table, when he says, invite the crippled, invite the lame, invite the people who are least like you. He says, blessed is the one who gets to sit at the table in the feast of the Lord. Now, this is not a mocking voice. Most scholars would say this isn't somebody who is mocking, somebody who is excited about it. But there is something to say that he somehow thinks that he is doing that. That because he is of the chosen, that he is sitting around this table, that somehow he is the one who's sitting at the table. Isn't it funny how we can think we've got it right, but then something happens and we totally recognize that we don't have anything right at all? It's more than us just being moved by what Jesus' story is. It's more than us just being moved by what Jesus is teaching us. We can nod our heads and we can say amen all we want at church, but there needs to be a further movement that happens in here. And this man at the table who says, blessed is the one, is moved by it. But so many of us do nothing, and perhaps he was one who was doing nothing to actually live that out. In fact, the Pharisees, if we're going to talk about the Pharisees, they did not just not do anything. They actually fought against Jesus, that they fought against the message in which he was declaring, because it was threatening to their identity, to who they were as a chosen people. Do we get like that as church? Are we afraid that if we invite others that somehow it's going to break down things that break down our identity and who we are? Or is it just going to be a little painful? Is it going to be something that just costs? That maybe it's not about me. Maybe it's not about how much I get out of the interaction. Is it perhaps that it's just what the other person will receive from me? And the only reason that I'm able to give of myself is because God has given himself to me. You see, pursuit needs some movement. It needs an initiation of what's going on. Not just a nodding of heads, not just a amen or a being moved by the message of Jesus. It's got to take form of us, manifest in us in such a way that our hands and feet move, that we are able to act and speak in such ways. For us, we need to be changed. And yet, in the story of this parable where Jesus invites these people to a great banquet, and he sends out his servant to say, hey, things are ready, now is the time, they all seem to have excuses. One has bought a yoke of oxen. One has a land. The other one just got married. And there are all these things of regular life, daily life, in which they're moving and acting. How many of us get caught up in our daily lives and forget, right? I know I forget sometimes. Sometimes my first interaction with the world is going to the cell phone and looking at my social media and my emails. How different would my life be changed? How different is my day when I decide to make that prayer first? Or when I decide to give honor of what God has done to be able to help me to get out of bed? What would it look like if you acknowledged God the first moment you woke up? Could your day be different? And so for these people, they are making decisions and based off of the regular things of their life. They have gotten caught up in the monotony of regular life. And they don't have time to make it to the banquet. They've turned down the invitation. And so what Jesus does is he calls out to the other people, says, go to the poor and the lame, go to the people on the streets and in the alleyways, and invite them in. And the servant says, hey, I did that, but there's still room. It's still not full. And Jesus says, the host says, go out into the countryside, in the country lanes, in the hills. Call them all to come. I want my house to be full. I want my house to be full. And so that's what happens. And there's a strong statement at the end that says, I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. Man, I don't want to miss that invitation. I don't want to miss the invitation of what God has for us. What the blessing of the banquet could look like. So we have to see that in this story, there's a tone to what's going on, a tone of inclusion, a tone of open-handedness, a tone that allows some self-determination upon the individual. In other words, Jesus doesn't force people to come to the banquet. But what he does is he includes not just the people who he invited, but those who are in the alleyways and the countrysides. But it requires a self-determination. In other words, he's not going to force us to the banquet. He didn't force those to do that thing. In fact, they just got caught up in what other things were going on in their life. There's a cool thing and a cool story in Luke 19. And many of us might be aware of it, but Jesus is walking into the towns. And crowds begin to, he's begun to make a name for himself, where people are gathering and waiting. And there's word that he's coming. And there's this man named Zacchaeus, who's this tax collector, one of the most ruthless, cheating men who just take money from the poor, from the people. Nobody likes him, low in stature, and he crawls up in a tree just to see who this man named Jesus. And what happens in the story is Jesus goes straight to that tree and looks up at him and says, Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house. He invites himself essentially to Zacchaeus's house. He initiates to him. He takes the moment to initiate what's going on. And in that story, in that time, it says that Zacchaeus declares, says, Lord, calls Jesus Lord. And he says, I'm going to give to all these other people. I'm going to pay back all those I have cheated multiple times over. You see, he was transformed by this moment with Jesus. But there's a tone, there's something going on in the story that we have to see. First, Jesus didn't necessarily evaluate him as non-worthy. If anybody was unworthy, it was Zacchaeus in the story. And yet he was the one who God pursued. That, can we see that maybe perhaps poor is not necessarily a wealth or a financial status? That poor could also be somebody who's lonely. Poor could be somebody who is needing a friend. Poor could be somebody who is depressed. Poor could be somebody who has made poor choices and doesn't have many friends. Do you see that God does something here? He approaches Zacchaeus and he uses his name. How powerful is that? We get so easy into this structure of bro, sport, hey dude, how you doing? How many of you guys have ever met somebody, right? And you forgot their name and you didn't have the guts to ask them what their name was. And he went on and on, and it got to the place where it was so embarrassing that you still do not know their name, and you find other ways to address them. Can I encourage us to be a people who have a tone that says people's names? I'm that weirdo that if you're wearing a name tag, I'm using your name. There's a couple times that people would go, how do you know my name? And I said, because you have a name tag on there, right? Like they don't even recognize or realize that they have a name tag that basically told me that. There's a thing that goes on here. There's another thing that Jesus does with Zacchaeus, something that happens in the transformation of Zacchaeus, that there is no record of him teaching or preaching to Zacchaeus. Simply having a meal and conversing and fellowshipping with them. That Zacchaeus calls him Lord and he's transformed, but not through the path of preaching. It wasn't that he invited him to church or that he had a 3-point sermon for him. That it was just this pursuit of relationship. That the tone of us shouldn't be about projects. It shouldn't be inviting our friends to church. It should be pursuit of relationship. And not just a relationship with us, but a relationship with our God. So that when we are in our conversations, in our home hubs, in our times with one another, that when we interact with each other, we learn from each other. That doing life together has spiritual benefits, even if there's not a Bible study or prayer. Can we value the pursuit of relationship? There's also a technique to pursuit. In other words, that Jesus draws from the close to the distance, to the distant. Jesus goes to the poor in the streets after the people who were invited, the chosen ones, the righteous, when they choose not to take seat at the banquet, he chooses the poor. And then he goes from the poor to the people on the countryside. In Acts and at the end of Matthew, we have the Great Commission who kind of says, and you will be my witnesses, and you're to go to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Do you see this kind of pattern of what's going on here? That it calls for us to kind of go past our comfort zone. Can I say that there's something in our culture, though, that we tend to start distant so that we can have distance? In other words, our pursuit isn't always for us to draw our hearts close to the distant, but we have allowed ourselves to be enamored by the missionaries, enamored by giving an hour or two or giving some money over to open house ministries, that we can be a people who support stuff from a distance. And this is not what we are to do necessarily, although that's helpful, but can I encourage us to be a people that aren't working out of distant connections? That we can connect our hands and our feet with our heart, that when we give from our wallet or from our bank account, that we have a connection with the mission of God, not just through the way we give, but the way we are connected in the ministry. That if we're going to support the food bank, let's go build food boxes at the food bank. Let's not just give money to it. Let's go, if we're going to give money to clean water across the world, why don't we go on a mission trip? If we're going to support, can we be a people who initiate those things? But I love the fact that it says that he started off with those who were invited, with those in Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Can we maybe see that we have gotten caught up in our religious practice and have stopped pursuing the people who are closest to us? That we have neighbors that we ignore on our way to the church. That we have coworkers that we've worked with and never have spoken to them about what it may look like for us to have life outside of work. Can we be a people who say, who stop writing off our responsibility for the people who God's placed in Jerusalem because we do things to the ends of the earth? They're all good things, but can we connect our minds and our hearts to our hands and our feet, so that we are actively moving and pursuing people with real solid action and relationship. That's more than just us supporting a ministry. It's us being in relationship with a ministry. That's more than us just pursuing a person. It's us being in a relationship with a person. Pursuit requires us to sojourn. It requires us to venture outside of our comfort zone, to break that barrier, to break the barrier of our comfort zone. We write off why we don't do something. Let me say that again. Let me try that again. Can I just say that we often write off the things that we give excuses, that we give reasons of why we don't do what we do? How many of you guys have never invited your neighbors to something because you're like, oh, that's just not me? Or we just say, oh, I'm not an evangelist, so that's not really me. Or I'm not that type of person. Or even names. I know some of us have a tough time with names. I get it. But can we be a people who still try to know the person's name? I'm not here to pick on those of us who are name challenged, but it's about us pushing out of our comfort zone, not making excuses for why we're not good at something, but to see if we can challenge ourselves to get better. It's work. There's a task involved. There's a task that we have to do. There's a technique. I had a person that I had coffee with this week, somebody who connected with us, with me, with the passing of Pastor Mark. And we were sharing about things that he used to tell us. And one of the things that I've never heard Pastor Mark say, but he said he used to always tell me, it's about knowing, doing, and being. He says, we're really good about knowing and really good about doing, but really not very good at being. And I began to think about what that meant. I wish I could have the time to share that or to discuss that with Pastor Mark. But when I think about being, it's this connection to what is going on in our mind, our knowing and doing it in our hearts are connected to the ways in which we are. That there's a full connection to the ways in which we're doing and acting. That when I pursue somebody, it's not just that my hands and feet are moving, but that I've prayed about it and that I've set it deep within our heart, and that there's an intentionality that happens. That when you send a card to somebody, that it's more than just a card, it's one that is sent in prayer and grace and power. That when I go and invite and have coffee with somebody, it's more than just having coffee with somebody in hopes of inviting them to church. That pursuit is this initiation that when Jesus met with Zacchaeus, I have a feeling it was more than just a meal. That Jesus was able to share much with him. And Zacchaeus experienced an interaction that he's never had before. Can we be a people who begin to hear the tone and the task and the technique that is needed for us to be, not just know, not just do, but to be pursuit, to exude it and exhibit it in such a way in which people go, that is something different than I have ever seen before. Somebody who always uses my name, always asks how I'm doing, invites me to things that I never thought we'd be invited to. I'm reminded so often that there are people out there that don't have a community. Often when tragedy and other things, hard times happen, I often say with Alicia, I have no idea how somebody ever survives or goes through something like this without the church. There are people in our lives who don't have people to call. There are people that God has placed within our arm's reach that we can reach out to, that we can pursue. People even in our own church. Not everyone is highly connected. Can we think about the person who's on the fringe? Can you think about maybe that one person that you have not seen? Can you find them? Can you find a way to reach out to them this week? Can we take inventory of who God has placed in our life? These are the practicals. Can we take inventory? That means sit down and say, God, who is it that you've placed on my heart and placed in my life? Who have I written off? Who have I began to allow my religious practices get in the way of me pursuing the people that you have put in my life? Identify your neighbors, your coworkers, your family, your church family. Not just the people you get along with. And let's face it, you don't just get along with everyone at church. Can we pick some of the people that we really struggle interacting with and still remind them that they're loved? Can we be a people who pray for them, who find ways to interact with them, to meet the needs of who they are? Remind them that they are part of something much larger and much more exciting, something that calls us to transformation and new life. What does it look like for you to have a tone of pursuit? In other words, what does it look like for you to use people's names? Can we start using names of people that have name tags when we go into Starbucks or other places? Can we invite somebody over for dinner? Maybe it's about time that we allow our house to be a place in which God is active, that the interaction that Zacchaeus had with Jesus could be what people experience in our homes. Can we take time to give something to somebody, to take something to somebody who is quarantined, that you know that they're not able to have interactions with people? Can we begin to be a people who just share a gift, bake something, make something, do something for the people that God has placed in your life? What kind of technique does God have for you? What trail has he had you start on? Most of us are sitting in a place where we're comfortable. Can we break that barrier and go into the places which we may not feel fully comfortable? He is a 16, 17-year-old boy who knew he needed to change, who knew that shutting people out was not the answer, took the step to make eye contact, and then to smile, and then to say hi. That is what we were called to do. Let us be a people who are doing that and recognize that it's got a cost, that there is a cost, a suffering to it, that there may be rejection, that there may be times in which we aren't received as well as we would have liked. Can we be a people who are relentless in the ways in which we initiate relationship with people? Because that's what Jesus did for you. That's what Jesus did for I. What would it look like if we all began to pursue somebody this week? What would it look like for us to reach out to one in need? Somebody who needs a friend. Somebody who's lonely, somebody who needs help. What would it look like if we as a church began doing that on a regular basis? I don't know about you, but I think God would begin to do some super amazing things. Let's put it to the test. Let's be a people who are about pursuit in tone and task and technique. God bless you. I'm sure glad that you're here with us.
We all start on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give of the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us, and we sing, come to the table. Sinners who have been redeemed, take your place beside the Savior. Sit down if you are free. Come to the table. As we sing, Lord, come meet this motley crew of misfits, liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. So that sin and shame that you brought with you, can leave it at the door. Let mercy draw you near. So we sing, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside Welcoming us to your table. May we do the same to those around us, knowing that we are all your beloved children. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us at Starting Grounds Church. We are glad to have you. If you're interested in our email list, please sign up through emailing startinggroundschurch@gmail.com. You can also find us at www.startinggroundschurch.com. You can also join us on our Facebook groups and our Zoom groups. If you're interested in supporting Starting Grounds Church, it is as easy as texting 84321 and entering the amount, which will send you over to a secure site. We hope that God has blessed you and that he continues to do that as you seek him.